Pianist Roger Kellaway, from his album A Jazz Portrait of Roger Kellaway. A jazz series designed to showcase the freshest, most dynamic talent in jazz. And they had a rather impressive lineup of stars. Well, that's it for this first hour, but we have a lot more jazz coming your way after these important messages. I'm Dick Buckley. This is Chicago Public Radio.
One day,
as well be spring. We did a program one time, the last hour, featuring Kenton ballads recorded through the year, and I had more comments on that show than I think any last hour that we've ever done. People just weren't aware of the fact that there are so many ballads in the Kenton book, and they had, well, an opportunity to play all the great ballads with the best arrangers in the business, and like the one you just heard. Next up, we have Gene Krupa and Anita O'Day. Anita, who I had an opportunity to interview when she came through town the last time, and found her just to be a delight. I was worried going into it because she had quite a bad reputation, but kind of putting disc jockeys in their place. But we got along just fine. And I think I had her worried when I said, next up we have my favorite record of yours with Gene Krupa. I know she was thinking of the blues, the one that she did with Roy Eldridge. And when I played it, she breathed a sigh of relief. It was the vocal that she did with the Krupa band of Tea for Two. Anita was one of the few girl vocalists with the band who was able to use her own style of singing. A little jazz, a little ad-lib, a little variation from the original. Most girl vocalists just came out there in their pretty gowns and the flower in their hair and sang the hits of the day. Anita came out there dressed sometimes in slacks, not always in feminine attire, sometimes very masculine in attire, except those high heels which kept time and punched a hole in the floor while she was singing. She sang songs in her own way, and that's why she was so surprised when I picked that as her favorite record. She breathed a sigh of relief. not her favorite record, my favorite record of the ones that she did with Krupa. Let's listen to the Jazz Giants of 56. They were the Jazz Giants of any year, but it just so happens they were recorded in January of 1956. Roy Eldridge, trumpet, Vic Dickinson, trombone, Lester Young, tenor, and a rhythm section of Teddy Wilson, Freddie Green, Gene Ramey, and Joe Jones. Recorded January 12th of 1956, the Jazz Giants of 56. I guess I'll have to change my plans.
Thank you.
I guess I'll have to change my plans. That was from the album The Jazz Giants of 56. And they were the Jazz Giants of any year. Just so happens they were recorded on the first month of that new year, 1956. We had Roy Eldridge trumpet, Vic Dickinson trombone, and Lester Young with a couple of beautiful choruses. Teddy Wilson was the pianist, Freddie Green guitar, Gene Ramey bass, and the drummer, who just slipped away from me. We have coming up next Quincy Jones. This is when Quincy was on his way up in the music business. He was an A&R man for Mercury Records on some of the sides in New York, and they finally moved him to California, and he was the main A&R man for jazz in California. The bossa nova was the latest thing in music and jazz, and they had Quincy do a bossa nova album. There's a track in the album called Chega de Saudade, or they translated as No More Blues, that is a real swinger. The rest of the album, I think Quincy phoned it in. But let's listen to Chega de Saudade. And Jim Hall is the guitarist. And I think Clark Terry is the trumpet soloist. We'll see. Quincy Jones and the orchestra. Thank you. That was Quincy Jones in the big band, and I wish they would have given the personnel for that band because it was an all-star group recorded, I believe, in the West Coast. Chega de Saudade, or something approaching that. My Brazilian isn't what it used to be. Let's listen to Louis Armstrong. Here we are in our second, well into our second hour, and nothing by Louis, and that'll never do. Let's listen to number 12. Okay, we'll see what number 12 is.
I'm confessing that I love you, babe. Tell me, do you love me too? I'm confessing that I need you. Honest, I do. Oh, need you every moment. In your eyes I read such strange things, babe. But your lips deny they're true. Will your answer really change things? Making them blue, making them blue. I'm afraid someday you'll leave me. Saying just can't we be friends? If you go, you know you'll grieve me. All my life and you depends on it. Am I guessing that you love me? Dreaming dreams of you in vain. Oh, I'm confessing that I love you over again.
Did best, those high notes. In his day, those were high notes. Nobody else played them that cleanly, that clearly. That was recorded April 25th of 1939. When people do impressions of Louis Armstrong, that's one of the things that they almost always do, I'm confessing. Here's the way Lionel Hampton used to tear it up wherever he worked. This was at Carnegie Hall, April 15th of 1945, when Hampton wrapped up his portion of the concert with the traditional Flying Home. Thank you. Boy, that brought the people at Carnegie Hall to their feet, didn't it? Lionel Hampton, one more time there with Flying Home. Arnett Cobb was the featured tenor player.